ready to go? Good evening. My name is Chris Browder, and as many of you know, I recently bought a new car. But what most of you don't know is that it took me over 2 months to get the car I wanted here. And it's not because there was a lack of Volkswagen convertibles in the state of North Carolina. There was not a single one in the state that was a manual transmission. And you're probably going, you bought a manual transmission. Do they still make cars with manual transmissions? And the answer is yes. 13% of all current sold vehicles are available with a manual. So tonight, I'm going to challenge you to give a shift and rethink your dependence on your automatic transmission. I am going to present three arguments that prove that the time-tested manual is the only choice for the internal combustion engine. Now, this is a controversial subject, and I'm going to take questions at the end of my presentation, but first, I would like to preview the three arguments. First, we're going to argue to logos. Logic, they cost less. Secondly, we are going to argue to ethos, ethics, they are safer. And lastly, we are going to have wonderful testament as to the argument to pathos, emotional, why you love them. So let's shift into first gear and talk about logic. Manuals are cheaper. I pulled this data from Ford.com and the fuel economy numbers I got from the EPA's fueleconomy.gov website on October 24th of this year. The manual transmission Ford Focus is $1,100 cheaper than the automatic, but the automatic is 1 mile per gallon better in combined usage. Most people would tell you that you will make up the cost difference in fuel savings, but you won't. Over 100,000 miles of use, you will only save $400 at $3.25 a gallon in the automatic versus the manual, meaning you paid a $700 premium for the automatic. But there's more. On October 24th, I called Capital Ford of Raleigh and interviewed their service department about transmission maintenance costs. And I was informed that the automatic needs fluid service every 30,000 miles, costing between $210 and $265. Averaged out, that's about $237.50. Over 100,000 miles of use, that comes out to $712.50 in maintenance for the automatic. No maintenance for the manual. And you're probably going, oh, but it needs a clutch. Yes, they told me that the average lifespan on a clutch is 125,000 miles. So if you trade the car at 100,000, there is no maintenance on the manual, up to $1,400 cheaper. Now that we have addressed logos, I want to shift gears and talk about ethos. They are safer. And I'm going to present this to you in the terms of performance as a safety feature. In his 2012 book, Engines of Change, A History of the American Dream in 15 Cars, author Paul Ingrassia lamented the very first Corvette, saying, quote, "Instead of a proper manual transmission that a driving enthusiast could shift with precision, the Corvette had a power-sapping two-speed automatic called Power Glide. Have you ever been stuck behind a bus in the mountains of Asheville in a rental car that could not move out of its own way? I have. Most of you have. You don't deal with that with a manual. When you say go to third gear and have power, it goes to third gear and has power. There is no delay. In researching this, I discovered that Consumer Reports maintains a website entitled Save Gas and Money with the Manual Transmission, updated the date I accessed it, October 24th of 2014. And there are two vehicles on this list that really surprised me. Every one of these vehicles, the manual is at least a half a second faster. But the two I was most impressed with was the Hyundai Accent. It's 2 seconds faster. That is enough time for airbags to inflate. And the Mazda was the most common and classic example. It was $3,000 cheaper for the manual, it got 3 miles per gallon better fuel economy, and it was 1.1 seconds faster. But there are other safety features. Because you can manually control the engine and the engine speed, you can use the engine as a brake to slow the car down and not put wear and tear on your brake pads. You can also pop start the vehicle if your battery goes dead with the help of two or three good Samaritans or a downhill incline. And probably one of the most applicable reasons is using both of your hands, you don't have time to sit there and play with your phone. But my personal favorite safety feature of a manual is its anti-theft property. So eloquently put by Como News reporter Steve McCarron on an article published June 24, 2014, he penned, "Teens attempted car theft foiled by stick shift." And the most notable thing about this is that 16-year-olds carjacked a 70-year-old woman with a knife, and she taunted them outside the car when they couldn't get it to move. So now that we have addressed ethos, we're going to shift gears again, and we are going to address logos. I'm sorry, pathos. James R. Healy wrote an article in USA Today on April 30th, 2012, entitled Stick Shifts Popular Again. And in this article, he talked about Ford. Ford reintroduced their Ford Focus in 2012, and they expected 4.5% of them to sell the manual. Demand exceeded 10%. Ford wondered why. So Ford conducted research. One in four Focus owners comes from a $100,000 plus income. Of them, more than 60% had traveled to Europe. Ford's logic? They drove a Ford manual as a rental in Europe, loved it, and wanted the same thing back home. Fantastic. We see this all the time on Amazing Race. Americans go overseas, they can't drive the Ford manual, you know, they get behind. But that doesn't explain why it's fun. So, once again, I went to the internet and conducted more research. I put it out on Facebook on November 14th. For 3 days, I got over 160 comments from three different forums in regards to why people love a manual. And the two that I present here were my favorites. One is a picture from Uli Umber, and this was posted on November 16th at 12:29 p.m. Ignore the small remain of her turbocharger. That is the five-speed shift pattern tattooed onto the palm of her hand. And her comment is, you see where I stand on this debate. Dana Wolf, who posted at 2:29 p.m. also on the 16th, told me that he learned to drive a manual because the car he always wanted was a classic air-cooled Volkswagen, and they didn't come with an automatic transmission. I did it for the same reasons. Other people responded from around the world. Martin Anderson from Denmark told me on November 14th at 3 p.m. that driving a manual makes you a part of the car, not just a passenger. And good friend of mine, Amy Surratt, here in Raleigh, also told me on November 14th that she didn't even consider an automatic for her two-door Jeep Wrangler. She said, quote, it's a lot of fun driving a standard. There's a fun factor in it as opposed to a stomp and steer. But my favorite response was an essay pinned to me on November 19th by Ted Roberts. And I just want to read a brief excerpt because I could not put it better myself. So what then, in my opinion, is the biggest reason? Character. A manual adds character to a car. It makes it less of a computer and more of something I can bond with. Even driving the same car for years, the clutch and the shift gates aren't always acting the exact same way. When the AC is on, I need to give it more throttle. When it's cold, the shift gate feels grainy. When it's warm, the clutch is lighter. My transmission has moods. And for my daily driving, that makes more of a difference. After all, I'm not measuring my driving in seconds. I measure it by how it makes me feel. I'm not a race car driver, nor am I obsessed with saving every penny I can on maintenance. I just want to enjoy driving my car. And that's a pretty powerful testament, because this is like skiing or snowboarding or hang gliding. You can't explain exactly what the appeal is. You have to experience it. But it was Phil Wagner of North Carolina who penned a letter in response to the editor of Momentum Magazine, which is published by the National Multiple Sclerosis Foundation, in 2009. And he said, quote, I was diagnosed with MS in the summer of 1985. And after diagnosis, I still rode my motorcycle, but not for much longer. The loss of dexterity pretty much ended my playing the piano and the guitar. Today, I find it difficult to get out of my boat. But I drew a line in the sand when it came to my stick shift. Multiple sclerosis cannot have that. And you might ask, what's the big deal about a stick shift? Wouldn't an automatic be easier to drive? And the answer, of course, is yes. But the point is, I like my stick shift, and I can still do it. And multiple sclerosis can't have that. Now, before I open the floor for questions, I would like to recap. We talked about logos, the logical reason. Manuals are cheaper. We talked about ethos, the ethical reason. They are safer. And through wonderful testament from people sourced around the world, we have seen that there is a pathos component, an emotional component to owning a manual. Now, I challenge each and every one of you, if you've never driven a manual, to find someone with one, I'm happy to do it, and ask them to teach you. If you know how to drive one, I ask you to consider buying one next time. Now, with that, I would like to open the floor for questions. Yes?
Hi, Chris. I just want to support your argument, actually. I've come from Europe, and like 90% of cars are stick shift. So when you get an automatic transmission and something happens, you want to take it to the mechanic, they say, no, don't not here, you know, take it to the dealer. We're not want to deal with that. It's too complicated. It's too expensive to maintain. Yeah, but my question is, you mentioned that like 13% of car sales, actually, these are the stick shifts. Do you know what's the sales like? What's the tendency? They are going up. They are going like declining, the cars with a stick shift.
So your question is whether or not that 13% of cars, whether
it's,
that's increasing or
going
increasing,
down. It's increasing, you know, it's a stable like.
So the answer to that, it has pretty much flatlined out at around 6% over the last two decades. It dropped down to 5.1% around 2003, but in 2012, when the USA Today article came out, it actually hit 7.8%. The second previous largest uptake was 6.3% in 2006. And so everybody was trying to figure out why is there a 1% increase? That's millions of cars. It's a big deal. And no one's come to a real logical conclusion. But to say that they are, they're stagnant, but they are staying the same, if not increasing slowly in their share. Thank you. Did that answer your question? Yes.
You said having a manual, you can save your brakes wear and tear. Can you explain a little more on how you would do that by
Certainly. So your question is, how do you save on the brakes by downshifting? So simply put, if you downshift into a lower gear, and you assume that you, for instance, best way to put this, you see a cop half a mile ahead, you cut two gears, you go from 5 to 3, the engine speeds up and then will quickly slow down. In an automatic, even if you use the automatic shifter to go down to 3 gears, it's going to maintain the speed it's at. That's how they're designed. In a manual, you cut fuel to the rail, the car slows down. It's not like you slam on the brakes, but it slows down. You do wear your clutch out a little bit, depending on how well you downshift, but as I said before, most clutches have a lifespan of 125 to 150,000. In our family, they normally don't get replaced below 210,000 miles.
Would you recommend downshifting one at a time, or can you skip one?
Depends on the vehicle itself for that question.
What kind of vehicle would you do that for?
I've had good experience cutting from 5 to 3 in all of my VWs and one of my Volvos. My Honda did not like that. It liked to go from 5 to 4 and then 4 to 3.
Yeah.
That answer your question?
Yeah.
Are there any other questions? Any further questions? Yes, sir.
Why do you think that there is so much more of a prevalence for manual cars overseas? Because I grew up in Mexico and Colombia, and it's the same way. Most cars are manuals in Europe. So why do you think that the automatic is so prevalent here as opposed to over?
That's an excellent question. Just so I understand it, why are automatics so prevalent in the U.S. when they're not prevalent south or north of us in Canada, Mexico, and certainly in Europe? So to answer that question, I believe that it is part of the American dream that you work smarter, not harder, thus the machine should do it for you. And while that is most certainly a cultural aspect, we have always been a wealthy nation, and so we can afford such luxuries. And over the course of multiple generations, not having the experience of doing it, you're just going to assume that's the only option that you have. Whereas when you look at European countries, they don't drive as much as we do. I mean, the entire European Union fits into pretty much the entire east coast of the U.S. to the Mississippi River. That's how big it is. From here to Memphis is the same as traveling from London, England to Turin, Italy, as an example. Most people don't do that. They take the train. So a car is not used the same way there. Thus, they have no need to go for something that, yes, is better in traffic, but what traffic are they contending with? And if the car does break down, they have transportation as a backup. We lack those things here. Cars aren't a way of life. Cars are a requirement to live here. And that is why I believe the automatic has become so popular, because it takes the strain out. But as many people have said, driving a manual is an adventure. Yes, I have actually changed my work schedule to not deal with the stupid people on Highway 40 and 147 and 540. But you know what? When I did that, I not only gained a better commute, I gained more time for myself during the daylight hours, and that's a change a lot of people can make. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, sir.
I have to put an opposing opinion out there.
Go ahead.
Just a little bit. How do you drink coffee and food? It is a challenge. I like my automatic, because I can sip my coffee and cruise along.
That's a very fair question. So your question was, how do you drink coffee or any other beverage while you're driving a manual? And my answer to that
coffee
is
more important because it's hot. You know, when it's really
Okay, well, even more fair. So my answer to that is, since there was no context of the traffic conditions, just ensure you know your vehicle well enough that you can maintain one gear. For instance, in my diesel convertible, I am capable of going from 20 to 50 miles an hour in third gear. As long as I maintain my distance accordingly, not a problem. And since I would assume that you're drinking like this and looking forward, you should be able to maintain your distance. That answer your question?
Yeah, I just spilled it.
If there are no further questions, I would like to thank you for your time.